Welcome back. We have searched up the castle for every remaining bit of item, and therefore we have a lot of stuff, a little bit more money than we start with, and a lot more stuff here. That means we have given the blacksmith a lot of raw material, and I hope it's yes, it's enough for having the first single scale and 33, Kozan. Kozane? Single scale? Oh, Kozane is a little bit better. These are the first real samurai armor we make ourselves. For being able to take a little more damage. Oh, I think the order is screwed up again. Let me correct this. And to do a little exploit. Therefore, we are up in the shrine room. We walked all the way from the outer citadel up and collected every item, every gold, every piece of everything. Because if you do this, you are usually able to get a real the first real samurai armor. And this will enable us to take a lot of damage. And this combined with Suido, we can make a trick, because the game wants us to travel down here, and we can travel down here too. But
go back to the southeast and seek help from the Order. It has been reported that the Dark Warlord's forces are fully entrenched in this direction.
To explain this, I have to explain the general layout of the world. Let's show approximately a very ugly graphic. You have four castles, Mori, or castle, Oda, Tokugawa, and Toyotomi. And these castles are connected via wilderness. That means you have in every of the four directions, you have one castle connected with a big ring. And in the middle is a big mountain where the Dark Warlord lives. And if we are going this way, we have to face monsters which are way too strong for us now. But with a little trick, you may call it an exploit. Let's have we have another armor. Oh, lacated scale. It's even better. Let's buy this too. We have enough gold. We can. Normally, these monsters will kill you instantly, but they don't kill you instantly if you have this better samurai armor. Look at my swordsman. Oh, not if the map. We have the next better graphic. This monster will kill us in instant. Expect we have samurai armor. And even if we have samurai armor, we won't able to kill them. Expect we use Suido, which reflects the monster's damage back to them. And therefore, we are able to kill monsters way better than us. This causes, this will lead to us having more experience than usual, and therefore the rest of the game will be easier. And the monsters tend to drop good items, which are we probably not able to use, but we are able to scavenge for the blacksmith and therefore be able to access better swords now. But this procedure, this little trick, has a downside. The monsters we are killing are so-called Tengus. Tengu, which are the correct pronunciation, tend to drop better equipment than other monsters. And if we do this trick, we will kill the unique Tengu called Fuji. If we kill Fuji now, he will probably drop something that is good for us. But we can't kill him later. Expect we use multiplayer glitches. We can't kill him later. Let me start again. If we kill Fuji now, he will drop a good item. If we kill Fuji later, he will probably drop us a unique item. And by using this exploit, we are preventing us from getting a unique item later. On this point, we want to know what will. At this point, the question is: do we want to be fast in the game by killing him, or be, or if we kill him later, we will probably get a unique. But our armor is finished. Let's pass this armor down. He can't take it. He can take it. Pass it down. Scavenge it. Oh, and we can repair this bow. Is everything all right? We could be better, but this should do it. It can lead to our instant wipe if we are not carefully. And we try to pull one tango at a time. Pulling enemies one at a time is very difficult in this game, but it can work. Use Widow, and let's Death Clan tangos. They are very hard. They are too hard. Let's run. Oh, I'm frozen. It's very bad. Switch on him. Can we retreat? Alive? Yes, we can. Okay. This didn't work that perfectly, but yeah. Yes, he fast regenerated. This is a problem. If the main character dies, and how to explain this? You have, you may know, you have these potions, and if you switch from your main character and your main character got all the potions, the now AI controlled character can drink the stuff as an instant and waste it this time. Okay, we did not get nothing. We did get nothing. This didn't work. But the first attempt always is a little bit tricky. But due to the fact that three people wiped, I have to wait. The Daimyo to regenerate is purple magic. So magic is back again. Let's lagging 1 pixel. Lagging 2 pixels. Being nearly wiped out, meaning one survivor, three dead, has a problem that the full purple energy has to be used a little bit to warp all three back. Used half to revive the first. Use half again to revive the second, and the third may regenerate very slowly. It's obvious that it's better to revive the characters with a lot of health sooner than the with less health, because they are regenerated in the shrine room by amount and not by percentage, meaning a character with a lot of health needs very long to be fully to recharge its health fully than one with less health, and therefore I don't recommend builds which are tending to give the characters a tremendous amount of health, because you can calculate this out, but a character with 500 health takes approximately 3 to 4 minutes to be fully regenerated. So. Next attempt, using Suido to reflect. Oh, we pulled a lot of tangos. This is a problem. But we are so close. Yes, we are so close to the switching area that we are able to get along with it. So I spent a lot of mana, a lot of Daimyo energy, or however this purple stuff here is called, to switching back and forward. Yeah, you have seen I call in the brick and ditch down the berserker, because the berserker needs to regenerate too, and it was stupid to revive the ninja first. I had to resurrect. It's not revive, it's resurrect. I should have resurrected the swordsman first. As I mentioned before, this is not meant to be done. This is a little glitch A little explorer, rather. And we have got one level up. And we have a problem with this one causing spells, frost spells on us, therefore slowing us down. This didn't went good either. In the normal case, you are managing to attract only one or two of them. I don't want to use a save and load over and over again. I could do it, but it seems there are... It looks like two or three of them already died. And now Swordsman get revived first. I said Swordsman get revived first. I don't know which pixel exactly is the middle. This? Yes, this was exact pixel. But little cut here, we see us again with a living and healthy archer. This should be enough. Let's take our team together. By the way, a little info. Here in solo campaign, if you are going to a diamond menu and set them back and to regenerate and then minimize the game, the game will complete stop, and if you open the game up again, the progress will be the same. An exception is multiplayer. In multiplayer, if you are in a multiplayer game, therefore you can minimize the game, do something else, look at YouTube stats or something, and go back. And if you go back, the game will running forwards in the background, and it's very likely that they are here then. Oh, he got level 3. Let's level him. He get 1 on KI and more strength, and let's have look at his spells. Oh, he got I leveled the counter spells, and the tango's using ice, therefore I using ice resistance, and the other use Suido. Let's save and punch. It's important on some instances to run back to the enemy, to run at the rearest enemy first, because he will use spells. This is Fujin, this is a unique Tengu. He will most likely drop something useful for us now. Oh, yeah, I changed region, but therefore I can regenerate a little bit, because Fujin himself is very hard to kill, because he got a decent amount of life, but he also so provides a decent amount of experience and some nice loot. I yet saw some nice things dropped by the other Tengus. Let me explain it again. Fujin is a unique Tengu. Later, if he is killed by high level characters, is very likely to drop a unique item. But now with our level 3 characters, he will not do it. Everyone should decide for himself if he wants to kill him or not. Oh, I forgot to reanimate the ninja. Therefore, little cut here, and we see ourselves again with a regenerated ninja. And we are back. We don't need all the key for the ninja to regenerate. Therefore, that should be enough. Use the Suido, save, and try to kill Fujin. Ah, he stays there where I can go, where I cannot go. It's a little bit not set optimal, but he's hit often enough to not be able to attack himself that often. Ah, let's throw him a little bit. Come on, Fujin, come to me. I dare you, come to me. This should, yeah, this is okay. This Suido, if he wants to hit me, yes, he hits me, and he's down. Nice. Tachi, gold, Yotsane, kunai, a steel shuriken, cursed, but better than nothing. Two level ups for these two guys, and one level up for the archer. I can easily run along and do this over and over again, meaning trying to kill higher level monsters, but it's not that fun to kill Fujin and his guys, his desk lantangos. It's okay, I think. It's a little, it's not really an exploit. The game let you do it without higher force, but let's look at the ninja. I tend to hire his vitality. His trench, the berserker, raise his keys and raise his dexterity to make him able to use better pole arms. Okay, where is he got? A lightning bolt I don't need. Flash strike is very powerful. It's let him attack more frequently. Oh, blade. There are some spells called blade something. They are passive damage increasement. That's very powerful, but I don't able to do it like level 8. But if I said points can be saved for later. Let's look what we are having. We're having a Tashi, it's a very good sword, a cursed ninja star. Oh, I forgot to explain cursement. Cursement is cheap but long, and it's a little bit annoying. It's not that important. He can't use it. He's not a level 6. Level 6, unidentified. It's a little bit better, but we are not having so much money. I don't identify it. And kunais, a special form of medieval Japanese throwing daggers. Oh, by the way, if you tend to buy items like here, don't always check the item you are currently able to get and activate it. It will be saved here, and then hover the next item you think would be great, like the Tashi, and you see you only need level 6 to get it, and then think if you want to spend money on it, because the most items are not that linear in improvement. Very infamous is the kunai. Here's the kunai, here are its stats, and here's the steel kunai. The steel kunai, the original kunai, needs min dexterity 105. And the steel kunai, the next better one, only needs 110, and therefore getting here is 7 to 24. That means that you get 5 more damage for 5 more damage in dexterity. That means the balancing is not always that great, and it can be that you are spending a lot of money on one item, while the next item is accessible with 5 more points or something. Therefore, I wanted to look for the best sword. Swords. The swordsman is only that good, that of a good damage dealer, because he can dual wield swords, but not all swords can be dual wield. For example, the Odashi. Oh, it's a Nodashi. The Nodashi cannot be dual wield. Therefore, it cannot be dual wield. Yeah, not dual wieldable swords are not be dual wield. Okay, obvious. Two swords together are better than most single swords. Dual wield swords are, with two exceptions, very bad and should not be used. The exception is this one. This is the Iaito. This is the former best weapon in game. Later came a patch which added a even better sword. Our goal is to get a Iaito, because the Iaito is the nearly most powerful sword in game, with 75 to 250 damage. Therefore, our goal is to reach level 20 to get 100 strength and 200 dexterity. This is our main goal. We reach that. On the one side we are leveling, and at the other side we are enhancing of items. but this will be the next episode. Let's watch how we are doing. Oh. With our gained additional experience and additional god items. If you are tend not to kill Fujin, the first money you spend, you should not spend this on samurai armor. You should spend this on swords to be... These are normal Tengus. These are can be killed easily because the game thinks we are going here. But they are dropping...
Have the strength to carry it.
Very less good stuff. So, scavenge. So, how long should this episode be? These are mounted magicians. They are always very easy to kill. Okay, close. Pick up everything you can. This can't be hurting using Guido. Oh, Tengus was doing a lot of damage. Therefore, they are quite cutesy enemies.
I do not have the strength to carry it.
I'm overburdened. I should sort my inventory in another way. I don't need this. Oh, components. I should do the components away. These are Tengu feathers. Collect them. They're important for later builds. No, we don't need this, but we can use this later. Oh, this is an important enemy because they are losing. I have to explain a little bit further. In Diablo, it's looks this way that nearly every enemy can drop every item.
Gods cannot accept that.
In Diablo, nearly every enemy can drop every item. In Throne of Darkness, the world looks a little bit different. Because, for example, Tengu feathers can only be dropped by Tengus. Furthermore, bows are more likely to be dropped by this pale woman here. And you have a drop set for nearly every other enemy. Tengus used to drop feathers. Swords and magical items, and Death Clan Tengus and Unique Tengus, like the Fujin, tend to drop Uniques too. And therefore, every enemy drops his own items. I think the explanation should be enough this far. I have to. Give them that. Oh, I reach a new level, 1 point on charisma and rest on strength. And take a look at. I should use. Let's spend the points of the passive bonuses. Again. There are some items only dropped by one kind of enemy. And every enemy has other chances to drop certain items. As I said, Tengus tend to drop magical items, unique items if they have a very high level. And this is important to know because we want to hunt certain items. For example, Tengu feathers. We need a lot of Tengu feathers, therefore we're going to kill a lot of Tengus. Yeah. More items to scavenge and more Tengu feathers. Therefore, Tengus are one of my favorite enemies to fight because they are quite cutesy, they are dropping good stuff, and they are easy to fight and have no annoying traits like escaping patterns, running away, or melee attacks like this woman here. And we want to kill certain enemies to get hold on certain items. In the beginning, a lot of Tengu feathers. And we want to these ladies to drop a hairpin. Hairpins are very rare and we need as much as of them as we can hold off. Yeah, was haben What we got here? Garkis. Some monsters kill each other, like the Garkis here, trying to kill the Tengus. But we want to kill both, because we want to have the experience points, and not the Tengus. And we got our first talisman. And we are already... And we are nearby wiped. Let's do a retreat. I'm still good and I got a next level. This is one mechanic I explained in the very first episode. The swordsman is leveling very fast in comparison to the leader. Level 5, 1 point on charisma, rest on strength. And we, I think we should have... it's only lightning resistance, it's rather boring. But this gives me a little time to explain the downside of this item system. Because some components we need are dropped by only a certain amount of enemy. And the certain amount of main enemy only comes into play at certain places. There are some components we will find only 1, 3, or 8 times. A limited amount of components. That means we have to spend these components very wisely. For example, only the magician in the Outer Citadel will drop Soul of Buddha. And this will lead us to only have 1 Soul of Buddha in the whole game. Expect cheating, next episode. And therefore, some components must be spent very wisely. I could easily take this armor, this starting crab armor, and mount the Soul of Buddha in the Kozane, but this will be wasting. And therefore, we must be very carefully where we spend which item. Variation of items we need for our build, and therefore I will save and get the first one of this, because here is, yeah, it's a Debu, and this Debu will drop something that, which English name I don't know. I will see. Please drop 2. Save. He has to drop 2. And it's got this annoying knockback mechanic. Drop 2. I said drop 2. Therefore, I will go out without saving. Load the game again. And kill him again. As... So long as he is so polite to drop 2. I said drop 2. Could you please drop 2? He don't want to. In a normal game I would kill him so often as long as he drops 2 demo blubber. This is a component with Leech, and Leech is the key mechanic in the game to stay alive. All good bites, all good builds on characters are either Life Leech, Mana Leech, or both. These are the only good builds which let you beat this game easily. But this is, but I think this episode is long enough. Therefore, you can. And subscribe to my channel here and subscribe to other channels here. Therefore, I say thank you for watching and sei gesund.